recorded by John Lothe and is intended for educational purposes. This recording is not to be sold or distributed for sale. If you wish to support the work and publishing of these recordings, please visit the John Lothe Patreon page. If you come across these recordings anywhere else without my expressed support, and find that they are requesting donations for presenting this work to you, you will not be supporting the creator by doing so. This is just a friendly warning to anyone who may fall prey to predatory practices I have come across recently. The Nazi regime. Coming to power, 1933 to 1934. When Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of the German Reich on January 30th, 1933, he was not yet 44 years old. From his birth in Austria in 1889 to the outbreak of war in 1914, his life had been a succession of failures. The 7 years, 1907 to 1914, being passed as a social derelict in Vienna and Munich. There, he had become a fanatical pan-German anti-Semite, attributing his own failures to the intrigues of international Jewry. The outbreak of war in August 1914 gave Hitler the first real motivation of his life. He became a super patriot, joined the 16th Volunteer Bavarian Infantry, and served at the front for 4 years. In his way, he was an excellent soldier, attached to the regimental staff as messenger for the 1st Company. He was completely happy, always volunteering for the most dangerous tasks. Although his relations with his superiors were excellent, and he was decorated with the Iron Cross, 2nd Class, in 1914, and with the Iron Cross, 1st Class, in 1918, he was never promoted beyond Private, 1st Class, because he was incapable of having any real relationships with his fellow soldiers, or of taking command of any group of them. He remained on active service at the front for 4 years. During that period, his regiment of 3,500 suffered 3,260 killed in action, and Hitler himself was wounded twice. These were the only two occasions on which he left the front. In October 1918, he was blinded by mustard gas and sent to a hospital at Passwalk, near Berlin. When he emerged a month later, he found the war finished, Germany beaten, and the monarchy overthrown. He refused to become reconciled to this situation, unable to accept either defeat or the Republic, remembering the war as the second great love of his life, the first being his mother. He stayed with the army and eventually became a political spy for the Reichswehr, stationed near Munich. In the course of spying on the numerous political groups in Munich, Hitler became fascinated by the rantings of Gottfried Feder against the interest of slavery of the Jews. At some meetings, Hitler himself became a participant, attacking the Jewish plot to dominate the world, or ranting about the need for pan-German unity. As a result, he was asked to join the German Workers' Party, and did so, becoming one of about 60 regular members and the 7th member of its executive committee. The German Workers' Party had been founded by a Munich locksmith, Anton Drexler, on January 5, 1919, as a nationalist pan-German workers' group. In a few months, Captain Ernest Röhm of Franz von Epp's Corps of the Black Reichswehr joined the movement and became the conduit by which secret Reichswehr funds, coming through Epp, were conveyed to the party. He also began to organize a strong-arm militia within the group, the Storm Troops, or SA. When Hitler joined in September 1919, he was put in charge of party publicity. Since this was the chief expense, and since Hitler also became the party's leading orator, public opinion soon came to regard the whole movement as Hitler's, and Röhm paid the Reichswehr's funds to Hitler directly. During 1920, the party grew from 54 to 3,000 members. It changed its name to the National Socialist German Workers' Party, purchased the Völkische Beobachter with 60,000 marks of General von Epp's money, and drew up its 25-point program. The party program of 1920 was printed in the party literature for 25 years, but its provisions became more remote from attainment as years passed. Even in 1920, many of its clauses were put in to win support from the lower classes, rather than because they were sincerely desired by the party leaders. These included 1. Pan-Germanism, 2. German international equality, including the abrogation of the Treaty of Versailles, 3. Living space for Germans, including colonial areas, 4. German citizenship to be based on blood only, with no naturalization, no immigration for non-Germans, and all Jews or other aliens climinated. 5. All unearned incomes to be abolished, the state to control all monopolies, to impose an excess profits tax on corporations, to communalize the large department stores, to encourage small business in the allotment of government contracts, to take agricultural land for public purposes without compensation, and to provide old age pensions. 6. To punish all war profiteers and usurers with death, and 7. To see that the press, education, culture, and religion conform to the morals and religious sense of the German race. As the party grew, adding members and spreading out to link up with similar movements in other parts of Germany, Hitler strengthened his control of the group. He could do this because he had control of the party newspaper and of the chief source of money, and he was its political figure. In July 1921, he had the party constitution changed to give the president absolute power. He was elected president. Drexler was made honorary president, while Max Ammann, Hitler's sergeant in the war, was made business manager. As a consequence of this event, the SA was reorganized under Röhm. The word socialism in the party name was interpreted to mean nationalism, or a society without class conflicts, and equality in party and state was replaced by the leadership principle and the doctrine of the elite. In the next 2 years, the party passed through a series of crises, of which the chief was the attempted putsch of November 9, 1923. During this period, all kinds of violence and illegality, even murder, were condoned by the Bavarian and Munich authorities. As a result of the failures of this period, especially the abortive putsch, Hitler became convinced that he must come to power by legal methods rather than by force. He broke with Ludendorff and ceased to be supported by the Reichswehr. He began to receive his chief financial support from the industrialists. He made a tacit alliance with the Bavarian People's Party, by which Prime Minister Heinrich Held of Bavaria raised the ban on the Nazi Party in return for Hitler's repudiation of Ludendorff's anti-Christian teachings. And Hitler formed a new armed militia, the SS, to protect himself against Röhm's control of the old armed militia, the SA. In the period 1924 to 1930, the party continued without any real growth, as a lunatic fringe subsidized by the industrialists. Among the chief contributors to the party in this period were Karl Beckstein, Berlin piano manufacturer, August Borsig, Berlin locomotive manufacturer, Emil Kerdorf, general manager of the Rhenish-Westphalian coal syndicate, Fritz Thyssen, owner of the United Steel Works and president of the German Industrial Council, and Albert Volger, general manager of the Gelsenkirchen Iron and Steel Company and formerly general manager of the United Steel Works. During this period, neither Hitler nor his supporters were seeking to create a mass movement. That did not come until 1930. But during this earlier period, the party itself was steadily centralized, and the leftish elements, like the Strasser brothers, were weakened or eliminated. In April 1927, Hitler spoke to 400 industrialists in Essen. In April 1928, he addressed a similar group of landlords from east of the Elbe. In January 1932 came one of his greatest triumphs, when he spoke for 3 hours to the Industrial Club of Dusseldorf and won support and financial contributions from that powerful group. By that date, he was seeking to build his movement into a mass political party capable of sweeping him into office. This project failed. As we have indicated, by the end of 1932, much of the financial support from industry had been cut off by Papen, and party membership was falling away, chiefly to the communists. To stop this decline, Hitler agreed to become chancellor in a cabinet in which there would be only 3 Nazis among 11 members. Papen hoped in this way to control the Nazis and to obtain from them the popular support which Papen had so sorely lacked in his own chancellorship in 1932. But Papen was far too clever for his own good. He, Hugenberg, Hindenburg, and the rest of the intriguers had underestimated Hitler. The latter, in return for Hugenberg's acceptance of new elections on March 5, 1933, promised that there would be no cabinet changes whatever the outcome of the voting. In spite of the fact that the Nazis obtained only 44% of the ballots in the new election, Hitler became dictator of Germany within 18 months. One of the chief reasons for this success rests on the position of Prussia within Germany. Prussia was the greatest of the 14 states of Germany, covering almost 2/3 of the country. It included both the great rural areas of the east and the great industrial areas of the west. Thus, it included the most conservative as well as the most progressive portions of Germany. While its influence was almost as great under the Republic as it had been under the Empire, this influence was of quite a different character, having changed from the chief bulwark of conservatism in the earlier period to the chief area of progressivism in the later period. This change was made possible by the large numbers of enlightened groups in the Rhenish areas of Prussia, but chiefly by the fact that the so-called Weimar coalition of Social Democrats, Center Party, and Liberal Democrats remained unbroken in Prussia from 1918 to 1932. As a consequence of this alliance, a Social Democrat, Otto Braun, held the position of Prime Minister of Prussia for almost the whole period, 1920 to 1932. And Prussia was the chief obstacle in the path of the Nazis and of reaction in the critical days after 1930. As part of this movement, the Prussian cabinet in 1930 refused to allow either communists or Nazis to hold municipal offices in Prussia, prohibited Prussian civil servants from holding membership in either of these two parties, and forbade the use of the Nazi uniform. This obstacle to extremism was removed on July 20, 1932, when Hindenburg, by presidential decree, based on Article 48, appointed Papen commissioner for Prussia. Papen at once dismissed the 8 members of the Prussian parliamentary cabinet and granted their governmental functions to men named by himself. The dismissed ministers were removed from their offices by the power of the army, but at once challenged the legality of this action before the German Supreme Court at Leipzig. By its verdict of October 25, 1932, the court decided for the removed officials. In spite of this decision, Hitler, after only a week in the chancellorship, was able to obtain from Hindenburg a new decree which removed the Prussian ministers from office once more and conferred their powers on the federal vice-chancellor, Papen. Control of the police administration was conferred on Hermann Göring. The Nazis already held, through Wilhelm Frick, control of the Reich Ministry of Interior, and thus of the national police powers. Thus Hitler, by February 7th, had control of the police powers by both the Reich and of Prussia. Using this advantage, the Nazis began a twofold assault on the opposition. Göring and Frick worked under a cloak of legality from above, while Captain Röhm, in command of the Nazi Party stormtroops, worked without pretense of legality from below. All uncooperative police officials were retired, removed, or given vacations, and were replaced by Nazi substitutes, usually stormtroop leaders. On February 4th, 1933, Hindenburg signed an emergency decree which gave the government the right to prohibit or control any meetings, uniforms, or newspapers. In this way, most opposition meetings and newspapers were prevented from reaching the public. This attack on the opposition from above was accompanied by a violent assault from below, carried out by the SA. In desperate attacks, in which 18 Nazis and 51 opposition were killed, all communist, most socialist, and many center party meetings were disrupted. In spite of all this, it was evident a week before the election that the German people were not convinced. Accordingly, under circumstances which are still mysterious, a plot was worked out to burn the Reichstag building and blame the communists. Most of the plotters were homosexuals and were able to persuade a degenerate moron from Holland named Van der Lubbe to go with them. After the building was set on fire, Van der Lubbe was left wandering about in it and was arrested by the police. The government at once arrested four communists, including the party leader in the Reichstag, Ernest Torgler. The day following the fire, February 28, 1933, Hindenburg signed a decree suspending all civil liberties and giving the government power to invade any personal privacy, including the right to search private homes or confiscate property. At once, all communist members of the Reichstag, as well as thousands of others, were arrested, and all communist and social democrat papers were suspended for 2 weeks. The true story of the Reichstag fire was kept secret, only with difficulty. Several persons who knew the truth, including a nationalist Reichstag member, Dr. Oberfohren, were murdered in March and April to prevent their circulating the true story. Most of the Nazis who were brought in on the plot were murdered by Groing during the blood purge of June 30, 1934. The four communists who were directly charged with the crime were acquitted by the regular German courts, although Van der Lubbe was convicted. In spite of these drastic measures, the election of March 5, 1933 was a failure from the Nazi point of view. Hitler's party received only 288 of 647 seats, or 43.9% of the total vote. The Nationalists obtained only 8%. The Communists obtained 81 seats, a decrease of 19, but the Socialists obtained 125, an increase of 4. The Center Party fell from 89 to 74, and the People's Party from 11 to 2. The Nationalists stayed at 52 seats. In the simultaneous election to the Prussian Diet, the Nazis obtained 211, and the Nationalists 43 out of 474 seats. The period from the election of March 5th to 1933 to the death of Hindenburg on August 2nd, 1934 is generally called the period of coordination, Gleichschaltung. The process was carried on, like the electoral campaign just finished, by illegal actions from below and legalistic actions from above. From below, on March 7th, throughout Germany, the SA swept away much of the opposition by violence, driving it into hiding. They marched to most offices of trade unions, periodicals, and local governments, smashing them up, expelling their occupants, and raising the swastika flag. Minister of the Interior Wilhelm Frick condoned these actions by naming Nazis as police presidents in various German states: Baden, Saxony, Württemberg, Bavaria, including General von Epp in Bavaria. These men then proceeded to use their police powers to seize control of the apparatus of state government. The new Reichstag met on March 23rd at the Kroll Opera House. In order to secure a majority, the Nazis excluded from the session all of the communist and 30 socialist members, about 109 in all. The rest were asked to pass an enabling act, which would give the government, for 4 years, the right to legislate by decree, without the need for the presidential signature, as in Article 48, and without constitutional restrictions, except in respect to the powers of the Reichstag, the Reichsrat, and the presidency. Since this law required a two-third majority, it could have been beaten if only a small group of the Center Party had voted against it. To be sure, Hitler made it very clear that he was prepared to use violence against all who refused to cooperate with him. But his power to do so on a clear-cut constitutional issue in March 1933 was much less than it became later. Since violence from him on such a question might well have arrayed the president and the Reichswehr against him. In spite of Hitler's intimidating speech, Otto Wells of the Social Democrats rose to explain why his party refused to support the bill. He was followed by Monsignor Kaas of the Center Party, who explained that his Catholic group would support it. The vote in favor of the bill was more than sufficient, being 441-94. With the Social Democrats forming the solid minority. Thus, this weak, timid, doctrinaire, and ignorant group redeemed themselves by their courage after the 11th hour had passed. Under this enabling act, the government issued a series of revolutionary decrees in the next few months. The diets of all the German states, except Prussia, which had had its own election on March 5th, were reconstituted in the proportions of votes in the national election of March 5th, except that the communists were thrown out. Each party was given its quota of members and allowed to name the individual members on a purely party basis. A similar procedure was applied to local governments. Thus, the Nazis received a majority in each body. A decree of April 7th gave the Reich government the right to name a governor of each German state. This was a new official empowered to enforce the policies of the Reich government, even to the point of dismissing the state governments, including the prime ministers, diets, and the hitherto irremovable judges. This right was used in each state to make a Nazi governor and a Nazi prime minister. In Bavaria, for example, the two were Epp and Röhm, while in Prussia, the two were Hitler and Göring. In many states, the governor was the district leader of the Nazi Party, and where he was not, he was subject to that leader's orders. By a later law of January 30, 1934, the diets of the states were abolished, the sovereign powers of the states were transferred to the Reich, and the governors were made subordinates of the Reich Ministry of the Interior. All the political parties except the Nazis were abolished in May, June, and July 1933. The Communists had been outlawed on February 28th. The Social Democrats were enjoined from all activities on June 22nd and were expelled from various governing bodies on July 7th. The German State Party, Democratic Party, and the German People's Party were dissolved on June 28th and July 4th. The Bavarian People's Party was smashed by the stormtroopers on June 22nd and disbanded itself on July 4th. The Center Party did the same on the following day. A series of pitched battles between the SA and the Stahlhelm in April to June 1933 ended with the absorption of the latter into the Nazi Party. The Nationalists were smashed by violence on June 21st. Hugenberg was unable to penetrate the SA guard around Hindenburg to protest, and on June 28th, his party was dissolved. Finally, on July 14th, 1933, the Nazi Party was declared to be the only recognized party in Germany. The middle classes were coordinated and disappointed. Wholesale and retail trade associations were consolidated into a Reich corporation of German trade under the Nazi doctor von Rettelen. On July 22nd, the same man became president of the German Industrial and Trade Committee, which was a union of all the chambers of commerce. In Germany, these last had been semi-public legal corporations. The breakup of the great department stores, which had been one of the Nazi promises to the petty bourgeoisie since Gottfried Feder's 25-point program of 1920, was abandoned, according to Hess's announcement of July 7th. Moreover, liquidation of the cooperative societies, which had also been a promise of long duration, was abandoned by an announcement of July 19th. This last reversal resulted from the fact that most of the cooperatives had come under Nazi control by being taken over by the Labor Front on May 16th, 1933. This last reversal resulted from the fact that most of the cooperatives had come under Nazi control by being taken over by the Labor Front on May 16th, 1933. Labor was coordinated without resistance except from the communists. The government declared May 1st a national holiday and celebrated it with a speech by Hitler on the dignity of labor before a million persons at Tempelhof. The next day, the SA seized all Union buildings and offices, arrested all Union leaders, and sent most of these to concentration camps. The Unions themselves were incorporated into a Nazi German labor front under Robert Ley. The new leader, in an article in the Volkische Beobachter, promised employers that henceforth they could be masters in their own houses as long as they served the nation, that is, the Nazi Party. Work was supplied for labor by reducing the work week to 40 hours, with a corresponding wage cut, by prohibiting aliens to work, by enforced labor service for the government, by grants of loans to married persons, by tax cuts for persons who spent money on repairs, by construction of military automobile roads, and so forth. Agriculture was coordinated only after Hugenberg left the government on June 29th and was replaced by Richard Dehr as Reich Minister of Food and Prussian Minister of Agriculture. The various land and peasant associations were merged into a single association of which Dehr was president, while the various landlords' associations were united into the German Board of Agriculture, of which Dehr was president also. Religion was coordinated in various ways. The evangelical church was reorganized. When a non-Nazi, Friedrich von Boldeschwig, was elected Reich Bishop in May 1933, he was forcibly removed from office, and the National Synod was forced to elect a Nazi, Ludwig Müller, in his place, September 27th. At the elections for church assemblies in July 1933, government pressure was so great that a majority of Nazis was chosen in each. In 1935, a minister of church affairs under Hans Kerl was set up with power to issue church ordinances, having the force of law and with complete control over church property and funds. Prominent Protestant leaders like Martin Niemöller, who objected to these steps, were arrested and sent to concentration camps. The Catholic Church made every effort to cooperate with the Nazis, but soon found it was impossible. It withdrew its condemnation of Nazism on March 28, 1933, and signed a concordat with von Papen on July 20th. By this agreement, the state recognized freedom of religious belief and of worship, exemption of the clergy from certain civic duties, and the right of the church to manage its own affairs, and to establish denominational schools. Governors of the German states were given a right to object to nominations to the highest clerical posts. Bishops were to take an oath of loyalty, and education was to continue to function as it had been doing. This agreement with the church began to break down almost at once. Within 10 days of the signing of the Concordat, the Nazis began to attack the Catholic Youth League and the Catholic press. Church schools were restricted, and members of the clergy were arrested and tried on charges of evading the monetary foreign exchange regulations and of immorality. The church condemned the efforts of Nazis, like Rosenberg, to replace Christianity by a revived German paganism, and such laws as that permitting sterilization of socially objectionable persons. Rosenberg's book, The Myth of the 20th Century, was put on the index. Catholic scholars exposed its errors in a series of studies in 1934, and finally, on March 14, 1937, Pope Pius XIV condemned many of the tenets of Nazism in the encyclical Mit Brennendes Auge. Attempts to coordinate the civil service began with the law of April 7, 1933, and continued to the end of the regime without ever being completely successful because of the lack of capable personnel who were loyal Nazis. Non-Aryans, Jews, or persons married to non-Aryans, politically unreliable persons, and Marxists were discharged, and loyalty to Nazism was required for appointment and promotion in the civil service. Of the chief elements in German society, only the presidency, the army, the Catholic Church, and industry were not coordinated by 1934. In addition, the bureaucracy was only partially controlled. The first of these, the president, was taken over completely in 1934 as the result of a deal with the army. By the spring of 1934, the problem of the SA had become acute, since this organization was directly challenging two members of the quartet, the army and the industry. Industry was being challenged by the demand of the SA for the second revolution, that is, for the economic reforms which would justify the use of the word socialism in the name National Socialism. The army was being challenged by the demand of Captain Röhm that his SA be incorporated into the Reichswehr, with each officer holding the same rank in the latter as he already held in the former, since the Reichswehr had only 300,000 men, while the SA had 3 million. This would have swamped the officers' corps. Hitler had denounced this project on July 1, 1933, and Frick repeated this 10 days later. Nevertheless, Röhm repeated his demand on April 18, 1934, and was echoed by Edmund Heinz and Karl Ernst. In full cabinet meeting, Minister of War General von Blumberg refused. A tense situation developed. If Hindenburg died, the Reichswehr might have liquidated the Nazis and restored the monarchy. On June 21st, Hindenburg ordered Blumberg to use the army, if necessary, to restore order in the country. This was regarded as a threat to the SA. Accordingly, Hitler made a deal to destroy the SA in return for a free hand to deal with the presidency when it became vacant. This was done. A meeting of SA leaders was called by Hitler for June 30, 1934, at Bad Wiessee in Bavaria. The SS, under Hitler's personal command, arrested the SA leaders in the middle of the night and shot most of them at once. In Berlin, Göring did the same to the SA leaders there. Both Hitler and Göring also killed most of their personal enemies. The Reichstag incendiaries, Gregory Strasser, General and Mrs. von Schleicher, all of von Papen's close associates, Gustav von Kahr, all those who had known Hitler in the early days of his failure, and many others. Papen escaped only by a narrow margin. In all, several thousands were eliminated in this blood purge. Two excuses were given for this violent action: that the murdered men were homosexuals, something which had been known for years, and that they were members of a conspiracy to murder Hitler. That they were in a conspiracy was quite true, but it was by no means mature in June 1934, and it was aimed at the army and heavy industry, and not at Hitler. In fact, Hitler had been wavering until the last moment whether he would throw in his lot with the Second Revolution or with the Quartet. His decision to join the latter and exterminate the former was an event of great significance. It irrevocably made the Nazi movement a counter-revolution of the right, using the party organization as an instrument for protecting the economic status quo. The supporters of the Second Revolution were driven underground, forming a Black Front under the leadership of Otto Strasser. This movement was so ineffectual that the only choice facing the average German was the choice between the reactionary mode of life, built about the surviving members of the quartet, army and industry, and the completely irrational nihilism of the inner clique of the Nazi Party. Only as the regime approached its end did a third possible way appear, a revived progressive and cooperative Christian humanism, which sprang from the reaction engendered within the quartet by the realization that Nazi nihilism was merely the logical outcome of the quartet's customary methods of pursuing its customary goals. Many of the persons associated with this new third way were destroyed by the Nazis in the systematic destructiveness which followed the attempt to assassinate Hitler on June 20, 1944. In return for Hitler's decisive step, the destruction of the SA on June 30, 1934, the army permitted Hitler to become president following Hindenburg's death in August. By combining the offices of president and chancellor, Hitler obtained the president's legal right to rule by decree and obtained, as well, the supreme command of the army, a position which he solidified by requiring a personal oath of unconditional obedience from each soldier. Law of August 20th, 1934. From this time on, in the minds of the Reichswehr and the bureaucracy, it was both legally and morally impossible to resist Hitler's orders.